Hello everybody, welcome to another episode in the DJ Anesh set, taking you along the airwaves of Southeast Asian history. DJ Anesh speaking here, I want to take this opportunity to wish you a smooth journey. We've been voted top in the charts once again, and I think it's safe to say we dominate Southeast Asian history charts in RVHS. We want to thank you for your love, for your support, for your loyalty. Click here to like, click here to subscribe, tell your friends all about it. You know what's going down, dab dab. If you look out your window to your left, you see a thunderstorm gathering. But if you look out to your right, bright, warm sunshine. What an appropriate metaphor then to describe what we are going to cover today. Today we are going to be looking at the economic development of Southeast Asian nations through a particular lens, looking at a particular term, looking at miracles. Do miracles happen? Even in Southeast Asia, can we see the miracles in the economic landscape? There can be miracles when you be okay. Going back to my smooth voice. Can we see miracles in Southeast Asian economic landscape? Are there really miracles out there, or are they just mirages? Illusions of the mind and of realities. Now look no further, today's podcast will cover this essay question, a popular one at that. We'll look at how we can answer this and how we can tell illusion from reality, reality from illusion. So if you are ready, you're ready to soar on the DJ Anesh airwaves, let's dive straight in. Okay guys, welcome to another episode from the DJ Anesh set. Today we are going to be talking about another essay question. As you heard from the introduction, it is quite a popular question among the JCs. In the old syllabus, I think it has come up maybe once or twice. But I think that it is an important question nonetheless for us to go through, because it does require us to approach it in a slightly different way. So I want you to see a trend. As I go through all these different essay questions that are to do with economic development, you can see that the content and the points, the actors that we're looking at, they are more or less all the same. The challenges, the outcomes, the strategies, the opportunities, you know, SCOOT, what's the other acronym? Escapes me right now. COSOT, that's right. You notice that all these things are the same. We're not really dealing with any new content as of yet. But we're looking at different angles and different ways in which economic development questions could be asked. Last week, I looked at a question on determinants. Before that, there were questions on importance. There were questions on effectiveness. So you can see it's all the same content, but we are looking at different angles towards answering questions, different argument frameworks. And today we are going to be looking at another question that requires the same content, the same points, and so on and so forth. But there are some added elements for consideration when we approach this question. So without further ado, the question here is this: an economic miracle. How far do you agree with this description of the economic development of independent Southeast Asian nations? An economic miracle. So just by the term alone, you know that this is a loaded term. It does imply certain things, and we will need to unpack them later on. And pretty much we are going to be dealing with the idea of effectiveness. We are going to be looking at the idea of success. We are going to be looking at outcomes especially. So you see, all the things that you did in the past will apply here as well. But because they gave you a loaded term, a term that has its own set of meanings and its own set of definitions, we would need to deal with the term in our argument structure. So constantly trying to address this term and to see whether it is applicable to the Southeast Asian economies that we have during our time frame. So that's what I constantly try to emphasize to you guys, that make sure that you answer the question, not the question that you want to answer. Wow, hashtag that, get it trending. Make sure that you answer the question and not the question that you want to answer. Okay? So, hashtag that, longest hashtag in the world, but hashtag that, make sure you like write it down somewhere and like repeat it 1 billion times in your head, because the questions are going to be nuanced. I wouldn't say they are tricky, and I wouldn't say the content is anything like alien to you. These are all things you're familiar with, but you just really got to reflect and to really decipher what the question's focus is, and then after that, you go and write your essay. Okay, so a lot of it has to do with the connecting portions of your essay, the explanation bits, where it connects back to the question. Those are the portions where you are really going to answer the question. It's not really going to be in the evidence, or it's not really going to be in like certain other portions, but it's really going to be in the explanations of your point in relation to the question. So the link back, the final explanations and all that kind of stuff, all these things have to be tied to the question, and in this case, it has to be tied very specifically to the idea of an economic miracle and what it is. By now, you should be very familiar with this slide already. It's the same thing. We are still on the same like subtopic within this theme, so nothing really new over there. I think I just, you know, keep wanting to put this in because I want you all to see that we are on the same focus, but we are dealing with that very different forms of questions. Now, the most important thing over here quite clearly is the term economic miracle. Now, just to give you an academic background, usually in books or in journal articles, when you read about them, you will see economic miracle. They are usually applied to certain states, not to all nations, but to certain states that have really showcased those kind of qualities lah, of being an economic miracle, having great adversity at the start, but then having great success towards the end. Wow, almost cried there. So traditionally speaking, I guess a parallel to your IH syllabus would maybe looking at, let's say for instance, the Asian Tigers. You can see that these kind of things specifically refer only to certain economies and not to all. Over in Southeast Asia, usually economic miracle, if you do, you know, see in Southeast Asian texts and all that, it usually is referring to Singapore, Thailand, Malaysia, and Indonesia. I've seen some cases where the Philippines is under this bracket of category as well. So I think also do consider the Philippines, but from the academic articles and books and all that, usually it's these four. And usually they are what we refer to as the newly industrialized economies, or the NIEs, or you can, you know, call them like high performing countries, because they exhibited such trends in terms of their development. So it is a term that refers generally to the post-independence economic developmental trends, more specifically in the boom periods of 1980s and 1990s. As I said just now, the period of growth, the scale of their growth, the pace of their growth is just massive. It is really fast, it is really big, and it is observable for everyone to see the level of success that these economies have achieved. So that is something that is very tangible and very observable. But I think having that great economic success, okay, in itself, it may not connect to the word miracle, right? A miracle has a unique set of understandings that is attached to it, and we must apply it to the context. So having immense success in itself, in terms of explanation, is not enough to describe a miracle, okay? Now, a miracle, you must introduce the context as well. You must introduce like kind of like the origin story. Or you must introduce the situational context that countries find themselves in across the entire timeline. Now, all these contexts, the origin story or the situations that they appear across the timeline, these contexts, right, must the situation must be really, really one of adversity, one of great, great, great difficulty, where the results seem very bleak, where the challenge seems almost impossible, where it's just an immensely, tremendously difficult thing to achieve. And no one would have given them a shot in hell that they would be able to achieve it, but yet they did. Okay, that's the key, right? No matter how it seemed, and no matter how bleak it seemed, they managed to overcome the immense challenges that faced them. There was a time when people said that Singapore wouldn't make it, but we did, but we did. There was a, okay, so that's the idea, right? It encapsulated in one of our national songs, the idea of sheer adversity and difficulty, but yet managing to overcome it. I think, therefore, you have those two components that would constitute what a miracle is, lah. And so within your explanations, in especially, you know, connecting it back to the questions term, you would need to show both the challenge as well as the strategies and the outcomes that, you know, overcame it or did not overcome it, depending on, you know, whether you want to agree with this statement or not. But can you see, we are still using the same framework, the COSOT framework or the SCOOT framework, you know, however you want to call it. We are still looking at challenges, we are still looking at outcomes and the strategies that help us to help them to achieve those kind of outcomes. So you can see that it's more or less the same stuff, but in this essay, really, really, really need to emphasize on the severity and the adversity faced in the context and the kind of how the situation seemed bleak and all that kind of stuff. And then there was a successful navigation and surmounting of all these challenges, and the level of success, as what I've encouraged you guys to do before. Development primarily can be quantified in terms of growth statistics and growth results, lah. And that has to do with kickstarting economies or expanding economies or even sustaining economies in terms of those kind of growth statistics. Okay, that's fine. But with regards to development, it is a much broader term. So I want you to also encapsulate some other issues as well. Particularly issues to do with equity or employment or education or whatever it is, but more social economic related kind of issues. And that would figure into your scope or your concept of development as well. That is not just chasing numbers, that is not just chasing profit, but it's also looking at society at large, looking into the welfare of people, making sure there's equitable growth, people are cohesive, moving together, you know, that kind of stuff. Because you can see that in some societies where there's too unequal wealth distribution, where there's too much disparity going on, you know, there are a lot of problems that could compromise on their development from that as well. So I hope through this slide you can see that the term miracle, once again, requires you to look at the context, the sheer adversity of it, and then nations being able to overcome that. Now, if you, using the same definition, using the same scope and all that, if you do not agree, okay, and you go against the academics, it's fine, no problem. You do not agree that these nations should be considered miracles, okay? You do not agree. It's okay. Continue to try that. What you would then need to do is to prove that, I think it's mostly going to come in the proving of the outcomes. Especially attacking the sustainability of outcomes or questioning the pace of growth and that kind of stuff, I think it's a bit difficult to come out and say that, oh, you know, the challenge, it wasn't that difficult in the first place. But I mean, you know, I think pretty much the challenges were quite difficult, lah. So it's not our place, I think, to question the challenges and say, oh, actually the challenges, they weren't difficult in the first place, lah. So yeah, what miracle, everyone got like so many things really, but anyway. I think that's a bit of a tough argument, but if you note the challenge and you see that nations crumble under the weight of these challenges, or at best they only achieve mixed results, or it was inconsistent, I think you attack the strategies and outcomes better than you attack the challenges, and you say that at the end of the day, no, these economies can't be considered miracles because they all suck. You know, economics suck. You suck. The whole world sucks. You know, that kind of stuff. Okay, cool.
We live in a cynical world. A cynical world. And we work in a business of tough competitors. I love you. You complete me. And I just had...
Shut up. Just shut up. You had me at hello. You had me at hello.
We live in a cynical world. A cynical world. And we work in a business of tough competitors. I love you. You complete me. Just had...
Shut up. Just shut up. You had me at hello. You had me at hello.
Now, but for today, I think the argument that I'm going to expose you guys to, I'm leaning more towards the yes, they were miracles part, and then, but I'm also going to show you the balance part, lah, and then to give you some ideas for that as well. So, my argument, let's say for instance, again, this is purely like hypothetical, like the argument can go like 1,001 ways, so it's really up to you. So high today. The economic miracle for me, yeah, largely based upon the four case studies. I would agree with that. But I mean, as I say about the Philippines, I might put that in as well. So to bulk up lah, my main argument, then it could be a main argument that is run by at least five case studies, which I feel might be a better situation to be in. So in terms of the criteria, they were able to successfully navigate significant, remember I told you about the adversity context, they were able to navigate significant structural and post-independent economic challenges to deliver high growth rates. Of course, you know, the statistics must be quite stellar. It must be not bad, lah. Like it can't be just something that is there but not really there. You must be clearly able to see a very, very positive and exponential trend with regards to their growth rates, either in large indicators like, let's say, their GDP, which is their national income, or you can even go down to sectoral growth like or manufacturing stats or agriculture stats, you know, that kind of stuff. I think those kind of things are fine as well. But not only do they have growth, but they have a considerable degree of sustainability. Remember, in order for it to be considered a miracle, it cannot be a one-off thing. Like, it must be a long-term sustainable thing. So, the element of sustainability, right, for this question is very important. It's a long-term assessment. You cannot say that something is a miracle at the start, but not a miracle at the end. That one doesn't really make sense. So, if you want to run the miracle argument, you must have enough information to make sure that the entirety of your assessment, you can prove that area of sustainability. So, sustainability in economic growth and other indicators, even in the face of significant external shocks. As I mentioned, the challenge is not just at the start. It can be along the way as well. Certain crises would appear, certain challenges would appear. But yet, they can still deal with these challenges and these crises, even though it may be very large. I mean, something even as large as the 97 Asian financial crisis, you can even bring that in. And if countries manage to overcome that, it will really prove that these countries are really miracles in the sense of the robustness of their economic systems, that it can generate that kind of sustainability. Yeah, ASMR for you. You can tell that I've drunk a lot of coffee today. Okay, so that is the miracle part. Now, what about the balance? If you know, want to look at the other case studies, or if you want to look at the other perspective, there are structural vulnerabilities in Thailand and Indonesia created during the boom period that led to economic decay to the brink of collapse during the AFC. So what I mean here is that at the beginning, at the initial phases of independence, perhaps I could argue that Indonesia and Thailand, they did manage to overcome certain challenges and there were good periods of growth. However, I would use the prime case study of the 97 Asian financial crisis to show that actually I wouldn't consider them miracles, because actually along the way, from the 80s to the 90s, while in their period of boom, while in their period of high growth, actually there were a lot of structural vulnerabilities, there were a lot of structural problems that were already inherent within the system, and it really all blew apart in the Asian financial crisis of 97. So you see the element of sustainability there. I say that, okay lah, you know, in the start, maybe they did do some things right, but across time, there were many significant problems as well. Now, again, this is the way I use Thailand and Indonesia, and I've seen kids who have used Thailand and Indonesia in a positive way. They are able to prove Thailand and Indonesia's sustainability throughout the entire time frame. So again, this is just a suggestion. It really is up to you to look at your case studies and to see how you want to manage them. Okay, I'm not really here to like dictate what kind of argument you should have. It's really up to you to explore. Here's mine. Here's a reference, and you can just, you know, build on that lah. Now, other case studies for Burma, okay lah, that one I think nothing to say lah. Huh? That's in our time period of study. There's nothing really to say that it was an economic miracle. I don't really think there's an argument over there for Burma. So it can serve as like an exception or unique case study for you if you need to. Vietnam is a bit tricky because I actually Vietnam, you can see lah, it can be used as a positive case study, and the miracle status can also be applied to Vietnam actually, because Vietnam's situational context is probably the worst lah among all of Southeast Asian nations because of the wars that they've been through. And yet, emerging out of the war, especially after the Doi Moi period, after 1986, you have huge periods of growth for Vietnam as well. You know, emerging out of that war context and coming to a stable level of economic growth, opening itself up to the world and so on and so forth, I think I can argue that actually Vietnam can potentially be considered an economic miracle as well. So you see, the case studies are quite fluid and it's really up to you to play with it. Academics have their own take on things, but you as a student, you know, you can manage your case studies around. As long as you have a cohesive argument and the evidence to back up your case studies, I don't think it should be a problem with how you manage them lah. Even if it deviates from mine or from the academics, it doesn't really matter at all, actually. Okay? So, going into the components of the essay, as I mentioned, for this miracle question, right, the context setting and the severity of the context setting is actually really, really important. I mean, we've looked at the colonial inheritance by now to a great degree already, and we see that most colonial powers left their colonies in a very vulnerable state, especially with regards to their economy. It was really narrow, really undiversified, no modernization, no industrialization, manufacture was almost at a zero, you know, that kind of stuff. So the structural challenge that Southeast Asian governments face was immense. Like, these are all structural matters, because you have to develop an entire sector out from almost nothing. Then, okay, you know, that's the goal. Then, you know, you have a huge need for capital investment. You need the money. You know, most governments at that point in time, you may not have that kind of resource. So, you know, you need to attract foreign investors and blah, 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 blah. So, you know, there's a lot of maneuvering that goes around. Even the state itself, like the government itself, it might not have the necessary superstructure. It may not have the necessary economic superstructure to kickstart all these modernization process. Now, what's the superstructure? Then, you know, they may not have the infrastructure, like physical infrastructure, like roads, docks, what else? You have street lights, communications, and so on. They may not have all these kind of stuff. What else goes into the superstructure? The economic coordinating bodies, like the Economic Development Board or an investment board. You know, this kind of stuff, they may not even have it. So all these things, they really got to set up from anew, actually. What else goes into the superstructure? They need capital flow. They need revenue to come in. They need money. They need investment from the government. The government can keep the or to inject the capital, you know, into these industries. So I mean, there's a lot of things that have to go into build modernizing an economy, and you can see the degree of the structural challenge that you see over here. Now, if that wasn't big enough, you know, all those things that I said just now, it just concerns the economic sphere. Most of these nations, as they emerge from colonial rule, they are new nations. Like politically and territorially speaking, they are new nations. So there's also a lot of socio-political issues that are going on with regards to national unity, with regards to political stability. I think there's a lot of chaos going on within the government and across the country. So that's an added severity to the structural situations that nations find themselves with. And therefore, you know, that really adds on to the level of intensity that the economic challenge is all about. Regionally speaking, some nations are also involved in interstate conflict. And, you know, that also kind of like requires their attention to deal with. It may take them away from, you know, the economic sphere and that kind of stuff. At this point in time, like let's say in the early period, you know, Sabah conflict, Confrontasi, merger separation, Vietnam War, you know, all these kind of things, it does take away attention. So that might affect the economic development as well. So you see, the context setting is quite important. You're looking at all these kind of stuff and you're seeing whether or not governments and nations were able to overcome these kind of things. So, okay, we have the context setting, in a sense, the challenge, right? And then now we go on to the other two components. We're looking at outcomes, we're looking at strategies. Did they manage to overcome it despite the level of difficulty that was attached to those challenges? And over here, I put outcomes first, and then after that, I put strategies. Why I did this is because I want you all to see that in a point development, like in a paragraph development, there is no fixed way. Like, it doesn't mean that strategies need to come first, then you show the outcomes and so on. Here, I show you that I put the outcomes first. I show you that these are the evidence to prove that they did manage to overcome these challenges. And then later down in my paragraph, I go on to account for how they were able to achieve this, you know, through the strategies that you see over there. So these are outcomes and strategies that are unique across Singapore, Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand, possibly more. And so you see, you present things collectively. When you go into the evidence, it might be individual. But these main points of explanation are going to be collective in that sense. So you really are trying to reduce the amount of repetition you have trying to manage four case studies in one paragraph or three case studies in one paragraph. So you need to think of these kind of things. So you can see my argument here is that in terms of outcomes, we can clearly see that they did manage to overcome the challenge despite, you know, how difficult it was. And then after that, these are the collective strategies. I can evidence them from the countries one by one, but collectively, these are the three strategies that I have over here. Now, as I said, it's not just the initial period. As you go on further into the timeline, perhaps the nature of the challenge changes, but the severity, you must still keep it consistent. The severity, you must still argue that these are really difficult challenges that cropped up across the time frame, just like how you saw in the early phase of independence. Now, the level of severity, the significance over here is also large. And governments are forced to deal with it. So it's not like, oh, I deal with the earlier problem, so now it's happily ever after. No. Along the way, you have more and more things that come up. And these things, you have to argue that they are of equal, if not more, severe than, you know, what was seen at the start. the focus here, as I said, might be different. The challenge might be different. Now it's more about issues of expansion and sustainability. We look at all the different kinds of crises that that sprung up along the way, or maybe there's even more, you know, political instability at the elite level or at the societal level that propped up. And we know of cases, you know, in the 70s, in the 80s, of all these kind of like societal disturbances. You know, going into this phase, actually, even something as simple as the structural need to expand your economy, like moving from ISI to EOI, you know, that in itself can also be seen as a challenge. It is an immense challenge for nations to switch from a domestic focus for their manufacture to a more export-oriented focus for their manufacture. So, you know, that involves same lah, a lot of like money, it involves a lot of contacts, involves a lot of effort on the part of the government and so on and so forth. So even that in itself can be seen as a challenge of expansion and sustainability as well. Whether or not governments manage to achieve that is debatable. But here I do posit the idea that they were able to. So once again, you can see my structure is consistent, looking at the outcomes, okay, manage to achieve it, then the various strategies across the four countries again. So you can see that it's more of a times two situation from the earlier part, just that the time moves from the immediate, but now to the intermediate to the longer term assessments. Now, as I mentioned, for Indonesia and Thailand, I think that, okay, I haven't really gone through AFC with you guys yet, and that will come in due time. But Indonesia and Thailand, just a spoiler alert, they are the hardest hit during the AFC. In fact, Thailand is the country that sparks it all off during the AFC. So Thailand was hit first, and then later on, contagion, in fact, and then it hit the rest of Southeast Asia. So I'm trying to leverage on that to show that actually in these two countries, while it might seem as if there was a very robust economic system that was going on there, where it seemed as if that things are going well and the sound management of the private sector, the sound management of the growth and all that, but actually there was a lot of structural decay, there was a lot of corruption, there was weak supervision, so on and so forth. And all these things we could evidence and we could see from the 80s all the way to the 90s, leading the way to 97 itself. So I'm really attacking that key element of sustainability over here. And I'm showing you, you know, in terms of outcomes, all the negative trends lah, that come about over there. I think don't worry too much about the evidence and some of the terms over here, like what's a current account, you know, that kind of stuff. For now, I think we'll just take it first, and you can just take the stats and whatnot. When we get to AFC, these are more technical terms that I will have to break down for you as we go on. I chose this picture for this slide because it's one of my favorite. Okay, so in case you didn't know by now, like Thailand is my absolute like favorite country in Southeast Asia. Like I love it to bits. Like I can go there like many times. There was 1 year I went there 4 times all by myself, like just to like chill out over there. Like Thailand is just this amazing place. And one of the places that I love to go every time I go back is this district called Sathon. And in Sathon you have this place, this tower that you see over here called the Sathon Tower. And it kind of goes by another name in Thailand. It's called the Ghost Tower. And I think if you want, I can share with you my stories of me and this tower. Because it is actually like barricaded. But many true seekers like myself, many true seekers like myself will break in. And then we'll climb to the top and we'll enjoy really nice views and all that kind of stuff. But basically, it's a building that has never been completed. And even today, if you do manage to break in and go inside, you see that this building is not completed at all. It's like it's really built on shaky ground. Like there are no windows or anything. So like if you're on the top floor, it's just like wind blasting at you and all that kind of stuff. It's like a construction site that was just never completed, lah. Anyway, why I put this picture here is because Sutton Tower was one of the... it's a good symbol to show, a good reminder of the Asian financial crisis in Thailand. Because Sutton Tower was meant to be a mixture lah, between residential and commercial. But there was just... they just ran into too many capital and money flow issues that this tower was just never ever completed. And of course, you know, the company behind this just, you know, just went bankrupt and that kind of stuff. And till today, amazingly, till today, this tower just sits there doing nothing at all. Like, literally, he does nothing at all. It's no purpose to this. It still looks like a construction site. And what, 97 to today is like 23 years already. Yeah, it's just there, like, out of nothing. Anyway, if you go to Thailand, you can go visit it. I do recommend it. But it is a stark reminder of the horror. And I'm not talking about ghosts. But it does serve as a stark reminder of the horror of the Asian financial crisis in Southeast Asia back then. Thailand was, again, one of the hardest hit. 8 quarters in recession. That's a total of 2 years in recession. That's a bit crazy, lah. So, I end up with this slide because I did mention about Thailand and Indonesia, but I also do want you to consider how are you going to use case studies that I really didn't cover much today, Philippines, Vietnam, Burma. How are you going to incorporate them into your arguments? And, you know, in terms of your argument, where do you stand? Do you believe that they are miracles? They are not? Okay, so this is going to be our discussion question for tutorials this week. And I want you guys to have a stand. I want you guys to have points. I want you all to have an argument. And same thing, during tutorials, we will use this question. And then we will discuss this question. People will share. And we'll consolidate for the entire cohort, the sharing. So do come prepared for your tutorials with regards to this question specifically. And then I hope to hear from you guys and I hope to learn more things from you guys because I really actually did learn quite a few things from our last discussion during tutorials. So I hope once again to learn from you guys and just looking forward to your responses. So thank you guys for hearing me out today. I hope that you guys are well. I hope that you guys are doing good. Holidays are coming soon, so just hang in there for a while more and then you can have a bit of a rest. Please take your vitamins. Please eat well, sleep well and stuff. Get them KFCs. DJ Anesh out.